It starts with a vision. In that, I have a responsibility to every other American who walks on the streets to have this shared history and to be able to help them to see those facets of the history and relive those ones that they know, but also to explore those ones that they never would have thought of. What stories do we want to tell? And even more on top of that, what stories do we need to tell?
In 2013, we had about 5 or 6 of those living history days, and 25% of our general visitor population came on those days. The other issue is on the visitation side, where you don't have a lot of African Americans coming to colonial history sites, just because of the challenges of interpreting slavery and just the way they feel about that. And in general, you don't have a lot of African Americans coming to colonial history sites anyway, or history museums anyway. They represent. Most museums are starting to do a really good job of getting at the highest rungs of the economic ladder and social ladder and the lowest rungs, but filling in between those two, I think, is probably our next challenge. It's just the easier distinction is African-American enslaved stories versus the free folk. But I think there's a lot of other things at play there, where you have your convict servants, your indentured servants, your wage laborers. You know, you can hunt and hunt and hunt and find one book on London Town from the 1970s. So people aren't coming to London Town with all this background knowledge. So it's a double-edged sword, where on the fundraising side, it's a little bit easier, I think, to get some of these big donors to support you, and there's some prestige. But on the interpretation general public side, like, the public comes with so many more misconceptions. Buildings, the actual buildings that survive from the colonial period, represent the buildings of the elite, because they were built to last. Whereas the common person's buildings were made out of wood or a little bit more ramshackle, so they're not going to last. So I think there are places like Annapolis, Charleston, Boston, and they see these wonderful, great, beautiful examples of colonial architecture and buildings and famous people and the themes that they represent. But I think something museums struggle with is that the general person's perception is skewed by that. It's hard to raise funds for something that is an average person's. When you talk to someone and say, yeah, I want to build an average person's home, that actually makes people interested, but, you know, to get them to give money is more of a challenge. As far as how to integrate the African-American presence in London Town into our interpretation and our programming, the archaeology for the carpenter shop, what we now call the carpenter shop, that was more just investigation, not knowing what would turn up. So the burial came out of archaeology, which was really just an investigation to say, you know, there was a town, most buildings are made out of wood, which means they don't survive, so let's start with archaeology and see what turns out.
Now, the unique archaeology here at London Town has shown us some of where they're coming from, not from the Caribbean necessarily, but the countries in Africa where they are coming from. And we can specifically look towards Angola. Now, archaeologists were coming in, we're pulling up the shadows of the foundations here, the footprints of the building. And we noticed a stain in the ground, pretty much right under this corner here. And if you feel like lying on our very muddy ground, you can see the grave marker. But it was a grave. We know there was a Western-style wooden coffin to create the stain, most likely. And when we looked inside, there's the shadow of a skeleton. Now, the skeleton, of course, is decomposed, but the enamel of the person's teeth had survived. So we pull up the enamel, we send it, identify it. You can't get much from enamel. You can get more if you've got the full tooth, especially if it's got a cavity, because you can pull DNA from the cavity. We didn't have that. We just had the enamel. It's a child, 3 to 5 years old, very young. But what's unique is that the alignment of the grave lines up with the joists of the building. So in order to put the grave down, you would have to pull up the floorboards, put the grave in. Of course, you can't pull up your joists, re-put the floorboards down.
And we found a slave burial beneath it, which is very unusual. You almost never see burials inside structures. This suggests to us that it's not just what they called country-born, what we would today call African-American people who are of African descent but born here in America and within the African-American culture. That is almost certainly a slave who has been taken from Africa and brought here.
Well, one of the challenges, particularly on the colonial history site, it affects a lot of museums, but colonial history views them very much white and black. Staffing of most history museums are white, so how do you get across that? And, or even if they're not the first person, assuming you put a black person in a costume, colonial costume, that's where 90% of people's minds probably go to. My soul arising ever, Lord, for the year of Jordan roll. Hallelujah, roll, Jordan roll. Roll, Jordan roll. My soul arising ever, Lord.
How did you get to be housemaid for such a distinguished founding father? Did you see the advertisement in the newspaper?
Did I read the advertisement in the newspaper? Why, yes. It said, wanted, one housemaid, no pay. Preferably mulatto, saucy with breeding hips. Must work 18 hours a day, 7 days a week, no holidays. But you get to wear a pretty dress, and if you're lucky, you just might carry some famous white man's bastard child. So, you better believe I read that, and I ran right over and said, sign me up.
Stories as there are of oppression and of all those things that we know about and we hear about with slavery, the thing that we really need to share with guests and that they need to understand is that these enslaved members of society were people. They were mothers, they were fathers, they were children, they were lovers. They had just as much of a varied way of being and being with each other and with society as the whites, as anyone.
Soul arise in heaven, Lord, for the year we draw.